positively to our media unit. This is the statement by the NAK Kenya Party, entitled "Lest We Forget." We find ourselves at a critical juncture where the forces of complacency and impunity threaten to drown out the calls for justice, equity, and accountability. The storm that swept across our nation in the form of protests and dissent may appear to have quieted, but the issues that ignited it remain unresolved. Let us be clear. What appears to be the quieting of the political storm is that an uneasy calm that leaves unresolved issues simmering beneath it. On the subject of abuse of human rights, the oppressive political climate continues unrelentingly to stifle the voices of citizens and to specifically target around various parts of the country persons, mainly youth, who are marked by the abduction squads during the protests. People have been arrested in Adiriva, in Mombasa, in Nairobi, and in many other parts of the country. We are getting a full list. The Ruto regime appears hell-bent on stifling dissent and any enjoyment of civil liberties by citizens. The constitution, it appears, has been cast aside by Ruto and his ruling elite. You remember his famous statement during his swearing in, "When I put the valuable down." It appears it's not only the valuable he put down, it's also the constitution that he cast aside. He cast aside the constitution and the rule of law. The law enforcement agencies, more specifically the National Police Service, have blatantly ignored court orders. We have seen arbitrary arrests, detentions, and arraignment in court on trumped-up charges. Since the start of the peaceful Gen Z protests, by patriots who waved our national flag and conducted themselves in a most civil and orderly manner, the police have unlawfully and needlessly caused loss of lives to over 60 people, mainly youth, according to the Kenya Human Rights Commission, and injured hundreds, some grievously, abducted many, some of them turning up dead in morgues, others in abandoned quarries. Further, police have arbitrarily arrested and detained hundreds. Some later released without charges after spending nights in the police cells, and others being arraigned in courts on trumped-up charges, ostensibly to intimidate and inflict maximum fear in the population so that citizens will fear expressing their views or enjoying or ever joining protests or expressing dissent. So the era of fear is back. On the subject of those who have lost their lives, we cannot be sure they are over 60 or over 100 or 200. You may remember the falsification of records at the city mortuary, where a protester's shot in Athi River was listed as an accident victim from Raila, thereby adding the agony and preventing his parents from being able to trace him expeditiously. How many more
falsifications of records. The Kenya National Commission on Human Rights tells us that there are over 50 people missing. Are they really 50 or more? Are the missing people dead or alive? Because it's since the 25th of June. It's almost 3 months. It is very sad that this is the situation, and we are not seeing any cooperation by the law enforcement agencies, any cooperation from the Ruto regime to establish how many died, to make reparations, to establish the whereabouts of the missing and bring closure to their families. We are also experiencing a spate of disobedience of court orders. You remember a court order, and those who may not know, issued by the Malindi High Court on the 24th of June this year and confirmed on the 17th July 2024 after inter-party hearing, meaning the state was represented in the hearing before the confirmation. These orders restrained the police from interfering with peaceful protests, using water cannons, tear gas, live ammunition, rubber bullets, or other crude weapons or draconian measures, and from deploying brute force or any form of violence against persons protesting. Picture this, the order is issued on 24th of June. 25th was the day of massacre of protesters at in and around Parliament and other parts of the country, and even within Nairobi. That was the peak, a day after court orders. Police have continued to arrest people arbitrarily. You will recall Nanename. People could not access the CBD and other towns in Kenya. There was such heavy police presence stopping people from gathering together, using tear gas. I went to town and I witnessed use of tear gas unnecessarily. Everywhere I see 10 people, tear gas, arrests. I was killed by a whisker myself. They have been using live bullets, countrywide, tear gas and batons to brutalize peaceful protesters and people who are going about their business. The media has not been spared. We saw on camera media people, a lady was shot in Nakuru. In Nairobi, we saw them brutalizing the media and many others that we have not witnessed in the media, but the complaints have been there. And we are saying it is not enough for the police to have a meeting with the media council or with any other sections of the media. We demand accountability. We demand accountability for violation of human rights, for death, for assault of both citizens and the media. And we must not agree to forget and lower our demands. We are here today to remind Ruto and his regime that we are waiting for officers who are known, whose faces were widely circulated in the media, some even their false numbers were circulated. When will they be brought to account? When will they get arrested? We commend the NSA, which has at least sued an officer for violation of human rights. And we urge, in the absence of any action, positive action by the Ruto regime, that as Kenyans, we unite and push for accountability. Remember, this was the main demand of the Gen Z. Accountability across the board in all affairs. We are seeing a period of increased impunity instead of a changed mode of governance. The Ruto regime is not only operating with impunity, but it is also encouraging impunity and thus a breakdown of law and order within the ranks of the police force and high-ranking public officials. This can only bring anarchy to our beloved country, which all people of goodwill must resist with all our might. We must continue to insist on justice for those whose lives were brutally taken, for standing up and exercising their rights as enshrined in the Constitution, and for calling for accountability. Lest we forget, every Kenyan life is sacred, and every drop of blood spilled in the fight for justice must be accounted for. In the light of these grave concerns, we will submit this statement and more details as a formal complaint to the African Commission on Human and People's Rights, to the UN Commission on Human Rights, and all other relevant organizations, as a state party, to the African Charter on Human and People's Rights, the UN Charter, and other international instruments. Kenya is obligated to uphold the rights contained therein. Our constitution demands no less. Kenya is, we will not hesitate to call out these violations on the continental stage and on the international stage, especially in the light of the increased, or rather, of the state having reverted to its default status, and of their using fear as a tool to intimidate and as a strategy to suppress the dissent. This has now become the official policy of the KK regime. As stated above, we have seen arbitrary arrests and abductions continue, targeting those who dare to speak and those who dare to demand accountability. We refuse to remain silent. We refuse to be accomplices to the betrayal of the people of Kenya. We must speak out for those who cannot, for those whose voices have been muzzled by a state determined to criminalize freedom of thought and expression, and to ignore the principles of the Constitution and not giving people a right to be heard. The Constitution they are trampling on demands that we as citizens defend it. It is actually an obligation of every citizen and of every public official to obey, protect and defend the Constitution. We must enjoy the rights that it bestows. We are approaching the 14th anniversary of the promulgation of our Constitution next Tuesday. We must reflect on how far we have strayed from its promises. The human and socio-economic rights enshrined in these documents are under siege by those who swore to protect them. The right to life is under attack. The right to freedom of expression and thought is under attack. The right to fair trial is itself on trial. The right to dignity is being eroded daily. And perhaps most egregiously, the right to education is being sacrificed at the altar of crony capitalism. You will remember that there is now a new method of funding education. And we believe it is deliberately designed to erode access to education. The introduction of the variable scholarship and loan funding model is nothing short of betrayal by people who enjoyed education funded by the state. It shifts the burden of education to the backs of students and their families, majority of whom can ill afford, violating the essence of Article 43 of the Constitution, which guarantees the right to education. This model, if if implemented without meaningful public participation, is not only unconstitutional but also discriminatory. It exacerbates the socio-economic inequalities that already plague our nation, denying countless young Kenyans the opportunity to better their lives through education. The latest assault on our rights is part of the same economic oppression that led Kenyans to rise and protest against the Finance Bill 2024 and other punitive tax measures. Just as Kenyans rejected the heavy hand of the state in imposing unjustifiable taxes that threatened to crush the livelihoods of millions, we must now reject this new oppressive university funding model placed on the shoulders of our students and their families. It represents an attempt to extract wealth from the most vulnerable and to consequently deepen the economic divide in our society. In a similar fashion, the ongoing CBC system, competency-based curriculum, which restructures secondary education and segregates junior secondary and the rest of secondary. You know, secondary years are four. So the first two are put aside away from the other two. We find this move illogical. Remember, every secondary school has four classes, from one to four. We are now in the process of building junior secondary schools. Why wouldn't we have the same secondary school house, both junior secondary and forms three and four? When I went to school, I wouldn't care to tell you how many years ago, but it's a while. It's a couple of decades,
about four or more.
I did the Kenya junior secondary examination before proceeding to form three and four. And those days, secondary school was one. It didn't stop me and others from sitting for junior secondary before it was abolished. You sat and it was not compulsory. You could sit for it, proceed to form three, but the best wished to get out and get employed, once you pass, you could get out. I passed, but I still proceeded. Why can't junior secondary be placed in secondary schools where we already have facilities? The money we are now setting aside to build fresh schools, when we have empty classrooms, should be used to create classrooms in the few places where none exists, and to revamp where we have least facilities. The segregation also is causing a very serious shortage of teachers in an already bad situation, because we never have enough teachers. A teacher teaching junior secondary can also take classes in the upper secondary. But now what is happening is that the JSS teachers are being made to teach subjects they were never trained for, because the two systems are segregated. We call upon a common sense approach, which is lacking, so that all the JSS teachers can be employed, and that secondary school is combined in the premises and not segregated, and we can utilize teachers in the classes for the subjects they are trained for. Failing to do so means that our children are being subjected to a lack of proper learning, because in most schools they will not have teachers, and if they have the JSS teachers, they are being forced to teach subjects that they were not adequately trained for. We also call for the reinstatement of the JSS teachers who were sacked because of protesting these very injustices.
under the formal employment of the 46,000 junior secondary school teachers currently being treated as interns. The trashing of accountability in the Ruto regime has moved to a higher notch. You remember that transparency and accountability are one of the foundational principles in Article 10 of our Constitution. And as I said earlier, this was the main demand of the genesis and the genesis of the protests. Where there is accountability, the regime will respect the rule of law, human rights and people's participation. Lest we forget that the protests on the finance bill came because of a refusal to respect people's voices, refusal to accept meaningful participation by the people. These are the same signs that we are getting now. Some aspects of the rejected bill, such as the fuel levy and other issues that this tone-deaf regime is now talking of returning. You have heard of talk of returning sections of the finance bill. As Kenyans, we must not accept this and we must continue to question. And this is the same script the regime is using to gift, not to concession, to gift the Adani group, our main gateway, the Jomo Kenyatta International Airport. I am saying to gift them because this is surrounded by opaqueness. Nobody knows what benefit Kenya will get by the discredited Adani group coming to operate in Kenya. Kenyans have been ignored, and even people working at the airport have been ignored. We are urging that we double our vigilance and we continue to resist and to question these violations of our constitution and of basic decency. The country belongs to us, not to the ruling elite. There is this thing in Kenya that when people get elected, they think they own the country and the people, and they know what is best for us. That is not what our constitution says. Our constitution gives sovereignty to the people, and everything, the people must be consulted and be involved in whatever affects them. So I'm urging that we be vigilant daily. We refuse to be complacent, and we refuse to be quietened by these intimidating state tactics and forces. Let us not forget the lives lost, our rights which have been trampled, the dreams deferred. Let us not forget the violation of the freedom of the press and the violation of human rights of media practitioners. We are calling for accountability across the board, and let us not take every incident as an isolated incident. Let us know that they are all adding up together, and if we do not stand up for our rights, nobody else will, and darkness is going to envelop our country. We must reject that. So let us not relent in demanding the full restoration of the guarantees of the human rights and civil liberties enshrined in our constitution for every single Kenyan. Lest we forget, eternal vigilance is the price of freedom. So we have to do this all the time. And we promise, as a party and as people, we will continue standing up for what is right. We thank you. Unless if anything was not clear, who is helping us with the press, you can take. Okay. Yeah.
political issues in the country. So the only people left, in my view, will be you and Kalonzo.
We've always been opposition, even without title. We do not need any title. And we've always tried to be good citizens who take up their civil responsibility in this country. This party will continue to stand up for what is right. We are not a party in government, we are opposition. And we are used to being on the opposition trenches for the longest. So you can expect that we will continue to do so, and our colleagues who wish to do so, we will collaborate with them. But I speak on behalf of NAR Kenya, and from NAR Kenya, and this is our promise to Kenyans. Whether or not our brother Raila goes to the AU and we wish him well, that he gets the job, the position doesn't change. He remains here, we still remain a voice. He goes, we still play our role. So our being in the opposition is not predicated on the presence or absence of our brother. It is a duty we take up seriously. Yeah. The university, you asked whether I will be going to court. I will correct you and tell you that, yes, I may go to court from time to time, but I do not practice law in the sense of having an office. So I did that during my youthful days. Today I cheer on those who file, and I may go to assist. But there are some within our ranks who are at that active stage. And when they run to court, we will give them moral and any other support that we can. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
But now since the narrative has changed, those who are actually part of that OBM, they have joined this board. Now they're seeing some of the section of the
minority. What has changed? I think that's a question better directed to the people who are speaking a different language. NAR Kenya is speaking the same language. We rejected the NARCO report, we rejected the finance bill, and we rejected standing with the rest of Kenyans. Anybody who has changed has a duty to explain, not ourselves. Yeah. If you allow us. Yeah. Asante sana, mbarikiwe tumeshukuru. Yeah. Yeah.